Andrew, welcome to my office. I have been in this office since 2009, so it's been a long time, you know.
Thank you, Fred.
Have a seat.
It's a wonderful office.
Well, it has many memorable photos.
Yes. It really is my honor today to sit down and have a conversation with you. When I look back at your origins, you started from pretty humble beginnings. Can you share your childhood and how you came through into adulthood and the aspirations you built up as you came through?
Well, you're absolutely right. But I don't come from a humble family. Actually, I come from a poor family. We were very, very poor. We were living in one room, five of us, including my mother and my three, young brothers and sister. Five of us were in a room of about 100 square feet. I was lucky enough to have received a university education at the Hong Kong University back in 1970, and I graduated in 1973. This is my 50th year of working.
It's a fascinating story, Fred, and the distinction between poor and humble. I think it's a very important distinction. What do you think is that secret of Hong Kong that enables it?
I believe that upward mobility is dependent in your own hand. It is not dependent on the macro environment. If you have the willpower to be successful and you work hard at it, of course you need some luck and you'll make it. That's my own belief.
And what values did you learn, Fred, as you came up and to your university years in terms of integrity, in terms of respect, beyond hard work? What values did you take from that and have carried forward?
I think when one, grew up like me, I learned to be humble. I learned to be an honest person. I learned to work hard. And I learned to respect people. Those are the basic ingredients, And when I look around today, some of the most successful people follow those principles. And those who don't will suffer in the end.
How did you start in your role in government?
First of all, I owed it to my old friend, Anthony Leung,
for
introducing me to the then chief executive, Mr. Sitch Tong.
Yes.
And I still remember vividly in 2002, Mr. Tong invited me to the government office and the chat. And we chat for about, an hour or so. And he asked if I'm interested to join the government. I was exactly 50 years old. I thought it's time for me to contribute back to Hong Kong, where I gained so much. And then I was invited to join his cabinet. I was most grateful for his acceptance of me as his principal official.
I think you made a massive contribution, Fred, when you were in government.
I could do better.
What were the highlights or the most challenging times you had when you were in government? And how did you navigate through them?
Well, I can think of at least two while I was Secretary for Financial Services in the Treasury. The first one was the promotion of Hong Kong's bond market. When I joined the government, I started the tunnel securitization bond. And then we issued also the $2 billion US government bond. It's the first issuance of government bond. The idea, of course, is to fund the government's deficit. But there is a bigger reason why we want to issue the bond. It's important to promote the Hong Kong bond market and not just the equity IPO market. And since then, I have seen the bond market being very, very popular now, and the size of the bond market has grown a lot. Alongside with the development of the bond market, we developed the asset management business by getting rid of the estate duty, and then the offshore fund tax exemption bill introduced in 2006. Those helped to make Hong Kong a wealth management center. So I took a lot of satisfaction in doing that.
Now, I think this is tremendous in terms of development of Hong Kong as an IFC.
Yes.
But also, of course, you have major roles in the private sector. The one which springs to mind at the moment is chairman of FWD. What have you felt you've brought into FWD in terms of governance and also in terms of your financial know-how, given your earlier roles?
10 years ago, Mr. Richard Lee invited me to be a director of FWD. Now the group has offices in 10 cities, including Hong Kong and Macau, and 10 million customers, doing very well. You know, partly is because the change of demographics in Southeast Asia, as well as the, you know, change in wealth accumulation, more health conscious, those factors affect the insurance business.
When you look at Hong Kong now, you look at the one country, two systems, you look at the links with mainland, your reflections on the next steps for Hong Kong as an IFC?
Well, I think there's no question that we owe to our motherland's development and support to become IFC today. I still remember vividly when I started banking, Hong Kong was not an IFC. Today, we are truly an IFC. And we have a very strong equity market. We have a very strong bond market, wealth management center, owing to very good supervisory bodies like the SFC, Hong Kong EX, Hong Kong MA. And we have the common law system, which works very well for international investors. All this, you know, make Hong Kong IFC. And these ingredients will not change. However, the macroeconomic environment, the geopolitical situation have changed, as we all know. So we really have to think hard about our next step. But one thing is for sure, we continue to rely on the support of our motherland, because they are one of the largest economies in the world now. They need our help to raise capital, as well as the internationalization of renminbi. All those are things that we could build on and continue our position as an IFC.
Question, talent. We've always been a wonderful magnet in Hong Kong for talent, particularly in financial services, either from international or from indeed mainland. What do you see now in terms of the talent in financial services in Hong Kong? What needs to be done in order to secure this access to talent?
Well, I have a lot of friends from abroad who work in Hong Kong. They love Hong Kong. Why? Because we are a lovely city. We are a safe city. You can walk around without fear, right? We are a city that make your living very enjoyable. We have entertainment. You can go to Lan Kwai Fong, have a drink. You can go to play golf. You have great food. Those are important. We have very good schools that helps the expatriate to make sure that their kids are well educated. That's important. All those factors make Hong Kong a very wonderful city for us to attract international talents. Not to mention, we have a very low tax base system, attracting a lot of people to come to Hong Kong.
Fred, I think we both totally agree on this. Hong Kong's been a great home and is a wonderful international financial center. But Fred, it's been a real pleasure for me to find out more about you today and to thank you for everything you've done for Hong Kong and also what you've done for financial services industry in Hong Kong. You have been an icon to us.
Well, put it this way, financial services industry is a wonderful industry, not just for Hong Kong. Many of the cities I know want to be international financial center, but only very few made it. Hong Kong is one of them.
Fred, wonderful.
Two truth, one lie. I used to live in a 100 square feet cubicle apartment when I was growing up. I used to have four part-time jobs during my university days. I used to work in Canada back in 1976.
Fred, I know you're a very hard-working man, and I initially think all three are correct. I think maybe the second one is false. Maybe you had more than four part-time jobs.
I can only take four. I was running around entire Hong Kong and Kowloon, you know, to make a living by teaching at secondary school when I was a second year student at Hong Kong University. So I can only do four at that time.
Fred, I stand correct. To think, I actually thought you did more than four part-time jobs.
Thank you. I wish I could.